Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is a gift of God. So hallelujah, Philip. Thank you for bringing that to us this morning to remind us that how are we saved? Is it through ourselves? No. How are we saved? We are saved through Christ. We are saved through Him. We are saved through God's grace. And it manifests itself in Him calling us and in us having faith. And so we can say hallelujah. And before we begin for us, and as we come this morning to look at Pentecost and the book of Acts, we are going to start with Psalm 16. And before we do that, we're just going to ask the Lord for His help once again. And so, dear Heavenly Father, we ask that You will speak to us through Your word now to see the redemptive hope that You bring, Lord. And we ask that You will transform our lives. We thank You for those words and that reminder that we are saved by Your grace through faith. And this is not of ourselves, it is from You. And so we ask, Heavenly Father, that You will help us to stand, that You will help us to have courage. And Lord, You know our hearts. We ask, Heavenly Father, that You will wash them anew, that You will cleanse us, Lord, that You will cleanse our minds, cleanse our doubts and our fears, and help us to see the hope that is found in Jesus Christ. We ask these things this morning in His good name. Amen. And so we are going to start this morning with Psalm 16. And I'm not going to cover the opening chapters too much from Acts chapter 2, verse 1 to 13, because I touched on them last week. We'll touch on them briefly. But I'm looking to do work our way through the rest of the text this week. But I'm going to ask Jackie, when she's ready, if she will read Psalm 16.
Serve me, O God, for in Thee do I put my trust. O my soul, Thou hast said unto the Lord, Thou art my Lord. My goodness extendeth not to Thee, but to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. Their sorrows shall be multiplied, that hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. The Lord is the portion of my inheritance and of my cup. Thou maintainest my lot. The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places. Yea, I have a goodly heritage. I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins also instruct me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me, because He is at my right hand. I shall not be moved. Therefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope. For Thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer Thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In Thy presence is fullness of joy. At Thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore.
Amen. Preserve me, O God, for in You I take refuge. I say to the Lord, You are my Lord. I have no good apart from You. And the whole psalm is based upon David's hope for redemption. And the key verse, there are many in there, and we're going to see them threaded through Acts chapter 2, but one of the key verses building into, You will not abandon my soul into Sheol or Hades or hell, all of the above. If you are not with the Lord, it is hell, is verse 4. Verse 4. The sorrows of those who run after another God multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. David here says, I won't even mention the false gods' names. I won't even mention what other gods are called. And I will never go to a table like we have before us, a table under another name that is not Christ's, that is not Yahweh's. I will not do it. And that's why David can then continue through the rest of the psalm to say, because I worship and honor you, Lord, you are my chosen portion. You are my lot. You are my cup. My cup overfloweth. How I bless you, Lord, you give me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me, verse 7. And we know that in the night time we can often not sleep. And what is the thing to do when we cannot sleep? To pray. And King David has had many sleepless nights, there was no doubt about it. And yet he is reminding us this morning of what to do, to pray. In the night my heart instructs me, what do I do when I cannot sleep? Meditate on the Lord. Think about him. Think about how good he is. Why? Because of verse 5. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. My cup, and you will notice the significance of that following verse 4 is I won't even come to another table to participate in any drink offering because it is a false god, it is a demon. We don't do that. And all of this morning is to say that when you get to the end of the psalm, you realize verse 10, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol. You will not let your Holy One see corruption, and you have made known to me the path of life. Well, all of this is about to be picked up in Acts chapter 2. And Peter preaching says this applies to Christ. And King David was being prophetic, which is a glorious thing. And so we are going to look at this morning, hope through suffering and hope through humility. And so if you turn with me to Acts chapter 2, we are going to seek to skip through the material. And so we will look to pick it up another time again, because it is very dense. So I appreciate how dense it is. But following last week, chapter 2 of Acts, verse 1 to 13, the Holy Spirit comes down. It does not consume everyone. It doesn't consume everyone because Christ has taken the wrath. He sends the Holy Spirit, which we will see later. And we have here a winning back of the Tower of Nations, or Table of Nations, all the way back in Genesis 10, the Tower of Babel, we have a reversal. We also see the fulfillment here of the Spirit coming down and being inside, indwelling believers. And in your Old Testament, in Numbers chapter 11, I think it is, there are verses about there being 70 priests and them meeting outside the tent of meeting with Moses and the Holy Spirit dwelling, but not staying. Why? Because the Messiah had not yet come to redeem the world. And so the Holy Spirit descends and wins back and converts, and everybody in the early church, right here in Acts chapter 2, which we have to grasp and get straight away, all about Christ coming, dying, it being the plan of God all along, verse 23. And there being hope. And for us this morning, throughout all of these words, and there are many, and I'm going to skip over masses, so I do apologize. But I just want us to look really at 3 points from the text that can give us hope through humility. And I want us just to learn one simple thing from this sermon. All Peter does is go through the basics. He doesn't do anything complicated. He doesn't do anything to manipulate. He doesn't do anything where he doesn't say Christ's name. He just does the basics. He does the bread and butter basics that you and I, 2,000 years later, are to do with people. He preaches Christ crucified. He preaches it being the plan of God all along. And he preaches you guys are responsible. That's all he does. And 3,000 get converted. Jesus said to his disciples, you guys will do greater things than this. You guys will do greater things than the things that you have seen me do. And so often when we look through the Gospels and we see Christ's ministry, we look at and we go, wow, he must mean that we can walk on water. We can raise people from the dead. First things first, we're not apostles. Our text says many wonderful signs were being done through the apostles, verse 43. Acts chapter 1 tells you that to be an apostle, you had to know the Lord in the flesh whilst doing his ministry. And if you want to bring up Paul, the apostle, well, he saw the Lord on the road to Damascus. And if you want to compare yourself to Paul, I leave that with you. I leave that with you. There are no more apostles today. Your Bible tells you the qualification you had to have to be an apostle. Acts chapter 1, verse 21. So one of the men who have accompanied us during all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from John the Baptist until the day when he was taken up. From one of these men must become with us a witness to his resurrection. There you go. End of apostleship. So, what does it mean to say you will do greater signs and wonders than I have done? It means preaching the word. Only just to think about Christ going around and preaching and how little converts he actually had. In fact, many people doubted. Many believed, many doubted. Many were walked with him, many then turned away from him. Are you also going to leave, he says to Peter? Who else has the words of eternal life, Lord? There are many, many times in your gospel accounts where the Lord is preaching to people and they're unsure. And then we know those famous words, when the time has come and he starts declaring publicly, you have said it so, that I am the Son of Man. You have said it so. You have said it so. You are condemning yourselves. Fine, crucify him. Crucify him. And for us, when Jesus turns and says to his disciples, greater works and wonders and beautiful things you will do than these, here we have it in Acts chapter 2. Peter stands up, preaches one sermon filled with the Holy Spirit, and 3,000 converted. Instantly. Instantly. Jesus Christ didn't even have 3,000 converts while he walked in and out around Jerusalem and Galilee. Peter stands up, does one sermon, preaches the basics. The basics. And the whole concept is the Lord was crucified, the Lord was resurrected, the Lord is at the right hand of the Father. And we see those words from Psalm 16 in verse 27. Earlier, but verse 27 we'll start with, through to 28. But you will not abandon my soul to Hades, or let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Brothers, I say to you with confidence about the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day, being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God has sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Messiah. Amazing. And King David was a type, a foreshadow, of being a prophet, priest, and king. Here we have him being, here we have it revealed that David was a prophet. He was being prophetic in his psalm. We know he was a king. He ruled over Israel. And as the king, he was also there to intercede for the people. Well, what is that? That is trying to fulfill what Adam was in the garden. Adam was a prophet, priest, and king. He was a king. He was to rule over mankind, over creation. He was to have dominion in a loving way. He was to rule with love. He was a prophet because the word of the Lord went to him, and he was to teach the woman what the word was and to have upheld her by making her abide to it. And he was a priest because he was there to intercede for her and any children. Adam is the first prophet, priest, and king. King David comes along, and he is a representative of that prophet, priest, and king. And we know that he stumbles into sin. Your entire Bible will tell you about David's failures and about how there is one who is coming who is going to be the prophet, priest, and king without sin. And Peter stands up and preaches it. He preaches it. And for us this morning, the three points that I just want us to draw upon for us as we think about hope through humility, I want us just to look at these three points, which is one, humility, the second, hope, and then the third, honour. And for us, if we start with verse 37, humility. Peter stands up and he preaches Christ crucified. And then he is saying to the people, Christ was crucified because this was part of God's plan all along. And yet, it was your doing. It was your doing. You are the ones who are responsible. When your lips said, crucify him, when your family and relatives and those around you said, crucify him, you are responsible. You are responsible. And so Peter is not shying away from sin. That is a very key thing that you and I struggle with. He is not shying away from sin. In fact, if you don't mention sin, you have no gospel. You have no good news. What is good news? We love the good weather because we in England experience a lot of bad weather. You can only have good news if you have bad news. And Peter turns and he lays down the facts and says, you lot crucified him. You crucified him. You're responsible. And he doesn't hold back. He doesn't hold back and say, you made a mistake, you did a boo-boo. No, he just says, you crucified him. You crucified someone innocent. You're guilty. You're responsible. And in doing that, in being honest, in preaching the truth to them, just look with me at verse 36 and 37. Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him, Christ, both Lord and the Messiah, Christ, this Jesus, whom you crucified. And notice their reaction. Their reaction is one where they turn and there is humility. When they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? What can we do? And that is the great challenge and question that each one of us has to ask when we are faced with this. What can we do? What can you do? What is it that we are stumbling in? What is it that we're sinning in? What is it, our sin, that nailed him to the tree? Brothers, you crucified him. And their first response is not to say, woe is me, or I'm a victim. And neither, and I don't mean this in any derogative way, but neither is it, that's a bit heavy, I have a condition. No. Their first response is, oh dear, I'm a sinner. And they are cut to the heart. And your Bible will tell you time and time again, just like it does in Hebrews, just like it says at the end of Revelation, behold, I saw a two-edged sword come out of the warrior Jesus Christ's mouth. Well, it's not a literal sword. Because your Bible in Hebrews turns around and says, the word of God is like a two-edged sword. It pierces bone and marrow. What is the most convicting, cutting word out there? It is judicial. It is Christ looking at us going, guilty, not guilty. That is what the word of God does, which is what the Holy Spirit's entire ministry is about. Convicting us so that he can comfort us. That's why we struggle with our Bibles. That's why we are in a society that doesn't want God's word anymore. We have never been in a time where we have access to it more easily, more readily, and yet we don't read it because it convicts us. And the key thing is, if it didn't do that, we should burn this book. Because God is there as a heavenly Father to raise us up correctly. And he wants to do that for each one of us. He wants to love us in that way. In a way that's painful. In a way that is painful because we're rebellious. But notice that in preaching the truth to them, not shying away from the fact that he just says, you guys crucified him, their first response is humility. When they heard this, they were cut to the heart. The word of the Lord came in like a two-edged sword, bam, cut them quick. Cut them to the core. And they are left vulnerable and exposed. And they say, what can we do about this? Is there any hope? Is there anything we can do? Is there any hope? And this is the thing about the gospel. If we can get the courage to say what the bad news is, your entire Bible is about God's grace and good news. That's what it's all about. As Philip gloriously opened with, I'd like to share this morning what we learned, and it was Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is a gift of God. Hallelujah. So God comes in to convict so that he can save. And this leads us into our second point. In their humility there is hope. In their humility, there is hope. Because just look with me, brothers, what can we do? What can we do? Verse 38 tells you. Verse 38, it's all, God is waiting ready to give them the answer, but he is waiting for them to say, we have sinned. And your entire Bible has that thing. I will offer you grace. Just come to me and talk to me. Come and tell me what's on your heart. Come and tell me where you're burdened, where you're weak. Tell me where you've sinned. We can reason together. I am a loving heavenly Father. I always offer you hope. And verse 38 reads, brothers, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And repent here means change your mind. Change your mind. We crucified Christ because he wasn't the Lord. rethink that. Turn away from it. Rethink. Was that wise? Was that right? Did you do a good thing? Repent, says Peter, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This here is not saying you get dunked in water and the Holy Spirit comes upon you. That is not what it is saying. We know this because John the Baptist is there baptizing people in the River Jordan. And what are they doing being baptized? They are going to John the Baptist saying, "We are unclean. Will you baptize us?" And John the Baptist turns and says, "I baptize you with water. There is one coming who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. He will give you the Holy Spirit." And what does that mean? It means that when we come to the Lord in confession and say, "Lord, will you forgive me?" As we think about the Word of God and its significance and its importance and its glory, the more we do that, God's sitting there saying, "I will reason with you. Yes, I'll give you the Holy Spirit. Who is my Son? He is the Lord. Will you pray with me? Will you come and sit and sup with me? Lord, you know that I want to, but my sin gets in the way. Good, I can work with that. I can work with that. What I cannot work with is you lot not humbling yourselves to say you're sinners." And that's what your Bible is. Every single person in your whole Bible who will not humble themselves and confess their sin, God doesn't work with. Every single person who confesses their sin to the Lord, God works with. Every single person. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. In whose name? Well, what does Psalm 16 say? "I will not even mention other gods. I'm only going to mention one. The Lord Jesus Christ. He's the one who forgives sins. And you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." I touched on this last week, but just look with me at verse 32 and 33 again on this point of hope. And Jesus, with his disciples in the upper room discourse, said, "I will not leave you as orphans. I will send you another comforter. I will send you another advocate." And notice verse 32 and 33. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Okay. "Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he," that is Christ, "has poured out that this that you yourselves are seeing and hearing." There is a beautiful, wonderful situation here, which is theologically profound. You will notice, as you see also in verse 23, that this Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. So in the Godhead, in the Trinity, there is a definite plan that the Son is going to come to die for sin, to reclaim what was lost. And the Father says, "Son, you have to do everything that I'm going to lay upon you." And John's Gospel tells you very clearly in chapter 5, "I have only come to do what the Father shows me to do. I have only come to do the Father's will. I don't do anything in my own name, I do it in the Father's name. I'm not doing anything random. Everything is the Father revealing it to me." How does he reveal it to him? Through the Spirit. And we see this language being used here, that when Christ dies, when he is ascended, he goes to the right hand of the Father. He goes to the right hand and he goes up to the Father and he says, "I have finished my work. You promised to give me the Holy Spirit to send to my apostles. You promised, Father, that if I did everything that you asked, you would send the Comforter. And Peter's saying, that is exactly what happened, and the Holy Spirit came down. That is what you are witnessing. That is what you are hearing. That is what you are seeing. And brothers, it is because you crucified the Lord. And so the gospel is all about there being good news because there's bad news. It starts with humility. What can we do to make ourselves right, Peter? And he says, he doesn't say do anything except believe in who Jesus Christ is, repent of your thinking, change your mind, change your heart, turn to him. But how much money do I need to give? Doesn't say that. Do I have to say my pleas and thank yous? He doesn't say that. How many times should I pray? Doesn't say that. He says, what shall we do? Repent, be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. In other words, are we this morning, like these men 2,000 years ago, sinners? If we answer no, we have no participation with Christ. Because Christ only came for sinners, which is everyone, which is every single person. And we may do our best to fight and say, no, I'm not a sinner. Maybe I've made a boo-boo. But a sinner, no. God is holy, holy, holy. God is holy, holy, holy. And when Isaiah is before the Lord, lifted up, the Lord won't even speak to Isaiah until Isaiah's sin is atoned for. That is the situation and the problem that we all find ourselves in. The Lord will not speak to us in our sin. And we go, where are you, Lord? And he's like, repent and turn to my son. Turn to Jesus Christ. And your entire Bible has hope. There is humility, there is hope. And to end for us, there is also honor. And the great question is, who are you and I going to honor? Psalm 16 is all about, I will honor no other God. Well, in the heart of Acts chapter 2, and I appreciate that in the original languages there were no numbers, there were no numberings, but they're pretty good. They're pretty good. If you divide most passages and you just go, oh look, there are 47 verses, and you go halfway, and you've got a give and take, but it's not bulletproof, but you will find the central theme that God wants us to learn. And everything else is great. There's humility, there's hope, but that's only possible because of verses 23 and 24. Verses 23 and 24, this Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God has raised him up, loosing the pains of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. That is what the Lord wants everyone to know. He wants everyone to know, we need to be humble, we need to have hope, but he wants us to know, who are you honoring? Who are we honoring this morning? And every other thing, God, person, that we honor is an idol. Your Bibles tell us that. Very quickly, Calvin once said, and I hope I quote him rightly, he said, the human heart is an idol-making factory. We are designed to worship. It is built into us. It is built in. And the question isn't, whether we are going to worship. The question is, whom are we going to worship? And here we have this theme picked up as Peter is standing there preaching, laying it out very simply, very straight, saying, Jesus was crucified for sins, you crucified him, you're responsible, but this was part of God's definite plan to win back the world. This was part of God's definite plan so that the last Adam, Jesus Christ, would win back creation. This was the definite plan that the Godhead had arranged. This was all God's plan. Why? Because God has raised Christ up to be at the right hand of the Father, because death could not hold him. And that should give you and I tremendous excitement this morning, because it means that we have someone who is at the right hand of the Father interceding for us, who is there, who is talking, who is saying, yeah, I've got you. You don't understand this, you don't realize it, but yeah, I've got you. I've got you. I'm just going to read these verses. After that motorbike goes, from Hebrews chapter 5, which reads this way: For every high priest chosen among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. The high priest can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. This is the Old Testament. And no one takes his honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So you cannot make yourself a priest. You have to be called, is what they're saying. So also Christ did not exhort himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, Psalm 2, verse 7, You are my son, today I have begotten you. Oh, after the resurrection, after the ascension, as he says also in another place, you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Forever. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. And he was a son. Although he was a son, sorry. He learned obedience through what he suffered. And just before I read the final two verses, just notice that. Christ is praying and his prayers are heard. And we know his great prayer. Father, take this cup from me. And the Father hears that and he says, You're here. For what reason, son? For this hour to be glorified. Go. Nevertheless, your will be done, not mine. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Well, for us this morning, we have a high priest who is also a prophet, who is also a king, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ, and he is interceding for you and I this morning. He is interceding for you and I this morning. And he wants each one of us to come to him to confess our waywardness, to confess our sin, to confess our sadness, to confess that we are cut to the heart so he can save us and love us. And I just want us to note, as the chapter ends from verses 42 through to 47, that we could add another H into our hope through suffering, and that is hospitality. And I don't just mean serving, I mean hospitality in terms of getting to know one another, in terms of giving of ourselves. The men are cut to the core. Peter gives them the hope, and then he tells them, who are you going to honour? This is the only way to be restored through the man Jesus Christ. Verse 42, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, to prayers. That is what a church is. That is it. A church may have other activities, the church may do all sorts of other things, but that is what it makes up a church. A group of people who show hospitality to one another by always seeking to honour the other more than themselves. They devote themselves to the word. They don't come up with any new doctrines or new stuff. They don't say this is outdated. No, they stick to what is written down because it is a two-edged sword that cuts us to the core. And as we read elsewhere, all scripture is God-breathed. All of it is profitable for us. All of it. And a church is made up of devotion to one another, devotion to the teaching of the Bible, of the apostles, to hospitality, of getting to know one another, of praying for one another, of seeking one another, of fellowshipping with one another, of asking for forgiveness of one another, to the breaking of bread. There is only one table. And to prayers. And we all stumble tremendously on the prayers. The church has always struggled with prayers, and that is why it is no coincidence that the only thing that is asked of Jesus to teach his disciples is, Lord, will you teach us to pray like John the Baptist taught his disciples? They can do everything else. Can you teach us to pray? And to end, Spurgeon once did a sermon called, or has within it, "It is always clearest after the rain." It is always the clearest. In other words, the sun shines the brightest after it rains. Well, you and I know that in our lives there can be moments of desperation, moments of sadness, moments of great sin, moments of agony and pain, moments where we're looking and we're going, Lord, I think that must be it. Time is up. Because we're in the storm. Because we're seeing the rain. And yet, in that moment of a verse 37, when we are cut to the heart, that is when the storm is breaking. And the rain is coming to an end, and the sun is coming out to shine. Why? Because we have nowhere else to go. And so don't fight the storm, don't fight the rain, accept the rain, accept the storm, and wait for the sun. And it is of no coincidence that as soon as it becomes sunny in England, our moods pick up. And we all know the sadnesses that are involved in life. We all know that. And yet the sun shines the brightest after the rain. There is always, for you and I this morning, hope through humility. It's always been God's way. It will always be God's way. Because God's word is designed to convict us, to comfort us, because that is the nature of the Holy Spirit. And with that, let us close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank thee, Lord, that you did not leave your disciples as orphans. That, Lord, as we look through the Gospels, we see them stumbling all over the place. That, Father, their unbelief is questioned all the time. They don't understand the mission of your Son until after his resurrection. And we thank thee, Heavenly Father, for your grace and your long suffering, your patience as a good father, that you are always there on the horizon waiting for us to come back to thee. And Father, we thank thee that your word is alive and active, it is sharp. And we confess to you, Lord, that we struggle to read it because we always feel under conviction. We always feel like you are just there waiting to give us a good hiding. And yet, Father, we ask this morning that you will teach us and help us to see that you are a good Heavenly Father. That your Son, Jesus Christ, took everything on the cross in our place and said, "It is finished." And Lord, we ask that you will help us when we are cut to the heart to be humble, to find the hope that is in your Son, and to honor him and him alone. We ask, Heavenly Father, for the courage to know that the storms of life will pass, that there is a brighter day. And we thank thee, Lord, that we can experience it this side of the tapestry as well as in eternity. You are so gracious, Father, that we do experience it here on earth. So we ask, O Lord, that you will teach us that you use broken vessels, broken people. Father, you use one of the most rebellious disciples to be your true son, to be the man who stood and preached your word, saying, "Turn to Christ." We thank you, Lord, for Peter's rebellion. We thank you, Lord, for his humility. We thank you, Lord, for the hope that you set. "Turn to my son." And so, Heavenly Father, we ask this morning that you will set us on our feet. Refresh us, Lord. Restore us, we pray. Help us, Lord, to be devoted to your word. Devoted, Lord, to knowing who you are. Devoted, Lord, to one another. Help us, Lord, to wrestle with our sin. Help us, Lord, to confess it to you. Help us, Lord, to come before your table, honoring you and you alone. And help us, Lord, to pray, Father. We need so much to learn how to pray. So we ask, O Lord, that you will teach us the basics and help us, Heavenly Father, to keep it simple. We ask these things, O Lord, in your Son's precious name, through your Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And with that, we opened this morning with Psalm 16. So what better way to come before the Lord's table than to reread Psalm 16. "Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. Amen. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones. Amen. In whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another God multiply." And we live in a culture that is trying its best to run to other gods, and we are seeing how well that's going. "Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out." No, I'm not sitting at that table. I will not do it. "I won't even take their names on my lips." That is how blasphemous it is, Lord, to worship other gods. I'm not doing it. "The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup." And we are coming before the Lord's table. "The Lord is my portion, he is my cup. You hold my lot. The lions have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I shall not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad, and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure, for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol. You will not let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the path of life, and in your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore." As we read those words this morning to come before the Lord's table, I just want you to all realize David says this about himself, and then Psalm Acts 2 turns around and says, actually, this is all about Christ. This is all about Christ. Every word here from David is prophetic, and the Lord Jesus Christ can sing every single line of that whilst he was here on earth. Preserve me, O God, I take refuge in you. You are my Lord, Father, I have no good apart from you. The saints here with me, they're the excellent ones. The sorrows of those who run after another God will multiply. The Lord saying this. Their drink offerings of blood I do not pour out. I won't even take the names on their lips. No. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. Again, I've already mentioned it. But Lord, take this cup from me. Father, will you take this cup from me? No, son. You are here to save the world. And this is the way you do it. By stooping to conquer. This is how you do it. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. Yes, yes, the Lord Jesus Christ did have a beautiful inheritance and does have a beautiful inheritance. Ask of me and the nations will be your heritage. Amen. And we this morning, if we trust in Jesus Christ, if we are willing to read his word, confess with our lips that he is Lord and Savior, if we are to think about him day and night and pray to him and say, Lord, forgive me. He says, you are my son. You belong to me. And yes, you could say you are my daughter. Amen. But when the Father looks upon you, ladies, he sees his son. You are my sons, you are my daughters, but I look upon you, I see my son. I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night, my heart also instructs me. The Lord, throughout his ministry at night, is always awake praying. It's incredible. He seems to get more energized through the night praying all night than he does going to sleep. I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. Yes, where does the Lord go? I say to my Lord, sit at my right hand. The Father says to the Son, sit at my right hand until I make every enemy your footstool. I will never be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad. My whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure. For you will not abandon my soul to the grave. You will not let your Holy One see corruption. And Peter says, hallelujah, that's Christ. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. And you could see the Lord Jesus singing that so gloriously, because it's about him. It is about him. And with that, let us just read those words that we are so familiar with. So familiar with. Well, in fact, I'm going to back up a chapter. Actually, I'm not going to read them. I'm going to read something else. I want you to read this. Oh, well, I'll read it. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 14 through. Therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. I speak to a sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. The cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Consider the people of Israel. Are not those who eat the sacrifices participate in the altar? What do I imply then? That food offered to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, I imply that what pagans sacrifice, they offer to demons and not to God. Psalm 16, I won't even participate in any other table. And Paul here picks it up in 1 Corinthians 10. No, I imply that what pagans sacrifice, they offer to demons, not to God. And I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Shall we provoke the Lord to jealousy? Are we stronger than he? In other words, do not take the cup or the bread and then go and worship other gods. That is what Paul is saying. He is saying there is only one God, there is only one table, and it is the Lord Jesus Christ's table. And we know those words. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And so, dear Heavenly Father, we ask now that you will teach us to come before your table and your table alone. Lord, we ask that you will set us on our feet, renew our hearts and our mind, convict us of our sin, and comfort us, Lord, that you are a Heavenly Father. That your entire purpose of sending your Son was to win us back. And we thank you, Lord, that in a world of death, there is life evermore at your right hand. And we thank thee, Heavenly Father, that that cup that Jesus drank, he did not pass up. We thank thee, Lord, for his obedience to thee, even unto death on a cross. And Lord, we ask that you will feed us spiritually on your Son by your Spirit as we take of this bread and this wine. Father, we think on this bread of Christ crucified, his body broken outside a city wall. And we ask, Heavenly Father, that you will help us to know, help us to be cut to the heart, and help us, Lord, for our hearts to be healed. Father, we thank thee that your Holy Spirit leaves us not as orphans, that whilst he convicts us, Lord, he is there comforting us every day, every hour, saying, turn to him who loves me. So we thank you, Lord, for that Lamb, that sinless, spotless Lamb who gave his life for the world. And we ask, Heavenly Father, that you will teach us to sing, as has been said already. Alleluia, what a Savior. We thank you, Lord, for your grace. We thank you, Lord, that salvation is all of you. It is nothing to do with us. Left to our own devices, we would fail. We thank you for your Son, the true prophet, priest, and king, who is at your right hand, who has the keys to death and Hades, who has the keys to pleasures everlasting. We thank you, Lord, that he is with us this morning. And we ask, Lord, that you will be with us as we take of this bread now, of Jesus Christ, crucified. So, Heavenly Father, we turn to him and we take this bread in his good name. Amen.